God deserves another hand clap of praise for being such a wonderful God. Amen. You see, today we are already reminded of our mission statement, our vision statement for the whole year. So let's repeat together that the first part. Let's do this together. I am a visionary. I see myself as God sees me. And that's another series right there. We still are working to see ourselves as God sees us. We continue to see ourselves through the eyes of people who mean us no good. We see ourselves through people who don't ever think we'll ever amount to something. We continue to see ourselves through all the failures and all the flaws and all the faults of the past. But we're going to see a slide later on that talks about that when God sees us, he doesn't see us in our faults. He sees us in favor. So we got to start seeing ourselves. You know God deserves another hand clap of praise right there. We got to see ourselves as God sees us. Second, let's go back and read this together. I am revolutionary. Why? I overcome all obstacles through Christ. Regardless of what the obstacles are, we're able to overcome them through Christ. We had a living testimony in this place on today. Just a few weeks ago, Brother Mike Bennett was in a car wreck that almost took him out. And he is here today worshiping and praising God. We have got to overcome all obstacles. We overcome these obstacles by ourselves, but through Christ. We can overcome all things. That's when we have. Lastly, I am what? Extraordinary. Why? I no longer what? Achieve, believe, or receive. Contrary to the word of God. I'm not going to try to achieve on my own, but achieve according to the word of God. What are we saying right there? What we're saying there is if we get off the path that God has for us, his anointing is not on our life to do what we want to do. He has anointed us upon our lives to do what he called us to do and what he chose us to do and what he created us to do. No longer believe contrary to the word. We then listen to all these phrases through all of our lives that have nothing to do with the Bible. You take one step, you'll take two. That had no end. The idea was I got to believe what the word has said and lastly do what? Receive according to the word. Not trying to take matters continuously in our own hands, but receiving what God has for us. In other words, a believer should never sign for a package that did not come from God. Amen. We're receiving what God sent. We keep taking what the devil sent instead of taking what God sent. God didn't give us a spirit of fear, and we keep taking fear. God didn't give us doubt. We keep taking doubt. God gave us love and power and a sound mind. So now we talk about now. So what do we do now? We do what? We operate in a spirit of exceptional excellence. Now, what are we talking about there? That if we take a look at our lives, now let's be clear. If there are some areas of our lives where we do exceptionally well, and there are others we've got no cruise control. And as a believer, at this point, every area of our lives, we are operating and continuing to thrive and strive in an area of exceptional excellence. Then, come on, give God one hand out of being in exceptional excellence. So then, now this month, we're talking about this. Let's talk about this again. Let's repeat this three times together. I walk in what? Righteousness, holiness, and godliness. I walk in what? Righteousness, holiness, and godliness. One more time. I walk in righteousness, holiness, and godliness.
What did you just say? What did you just say?
I walk in righteousness, holiness, and godliness.
I'm okay to see. So how many in here this whole month is about being righteous? I need to see the hands raised high, toes and everything of those who are consistently righteous. Psalm 55, 1 through 22. Are we going to come back to business again? Be clear about it. Psalm 55, 1 through 22. What I want to share today is we're going to go back in, and I want to make sure we have our points early on because we need to go back and continue to lay this foundation for recognizing that we walk in holiness, righteousness, godliness, holiness, and godliness. So if you would turn with me now to Psalm 55, wonderful portion of scripture that we have here. And want to lay out this scripture here. There are only 23 verses. And we're certainly not going to read all 22 of the 23 verses now. But I want us to look at Psalm 55. And I want us to go back in as I share this, as we read this, David is going through one of the most challenging, difficult times in his life. And look at the promises that God makes to him. And he's not going through a time where everything is going well, but at one of the lowest points in his life, we're going to see what the Word has to say. Because again, in the midst of walking in holiness and godliness and righteousness, does not mean that problems will not come. Amen, son. It doesn't mean that pain is not at the door waiting for you. Does not mean that there's some situations there that are designed and sent by the devil to take us out. But I can't control all the things that happen to me, but I can control how I respond to what happens to me. And watch how David, and I wish we read this, I'm going to tell you a little bit more. In fact, let me share with you now about this background as we go back and start reading this one. The background. Before we read Psalm 55, this is what's going on. Now, it is not as if all the Psalms are written in chronological order. Like, it didn't necessarily mean that what happened in Psalm 55, 54 came before 55. And at different points throughout the Word, we have to be aware of what's occurring to have an appreciation for why he's saying this. So now, what is happening here? So David, as you know, had a lot of wives and a lot of baby mamas. And well, as a result of this, he had a son named Absalom. Absalom decided, and some things occurred from before then, that Absalom was disappointed with David for not handling things when his sister was raped, as you recall, from before. And so Absalom held on to a grudge for his dad, David, for quite some time. And what would happen, and because David did not respond the way Absalom thought he should respond, so what Absalom did was he would wait at the gate. So if you imagine in the door, the door here, it is the way that everybody's coming to get to David. Absalom was outside the door. And every time people were going to talk to David about whatever their challenges were, Absalom would find out what was going on. Well, why are you here to see the king? Well, because of this, this, and this. And when the person left dissatisfied, Absalom was out there saying, no, if I were king, I would have addressed that for you. If I were king, I would have done this. So he stayed out there for continuously, going back and forth. So people are coming in and going out dissatisfied. And so in turn, they let Trump, So as a result of this, they went back and forth. And they stood at the door making promises he knew he could not fulfill. And after a while, after he had gotten a lot of the kingdom turning against David, then one day David is in his palace, and all of a sudden he hears the words, Absalom is king. Absalom is king. And David is hearing that, and he barely has time to take a few people and a few of his belongings and get out of town before Absalom and his army are getting ready to have a coup to take him over. So then David is on the run because his own flesh and blood has come against him to take over. Now, you know, God is a restorer. But here David was in the midst of recognizing bone of my bone has turned against me. Flesh of my flesh has turned against me. And as a result of this, David is on the run. And that's what the backdrop is of Psalm 55. Every psalm we have, not all of them were written by David. But this psalm was written by David after his own son had turned against him to rule the kingdom. If you look at the story, now you know God is not going to just sit back and let his kingdom run away. So Absalom later dies, and David gets restored. But in the midst of that, it is hard sometimes in our Christian journey to get to see the end when you're right there in the middle. It is hard to know you already have victory when everything you see is failure. It is hard to believe and accept the fact that at this point, God is still good and God is still great. When you look around, there's nothing but darkness all around you. So here David writes Psalm 55. While he is on the run from his own son, and not only did Absalom take over the palace and take over the kingdom, he sent an army out to find his daddy to kill him. So David is on the run and talking to the Lord, and now we can eavesdrop on his conversation. Psalm 55, verses 1 through 23. I want to have us read verses 4 through 6 first, then we're going to skip down to 12 through 14, our minds about this, and then lastly with verse 22. So once you repeat after me, I'm ready
to receive the word.
I'm excited.
I'm excited.
about receiving the word.
I am prepared
to receive the word. If nobody else is excited, I know Brother Lewis is. And I just praise God for him. Send on to me about it. Ain't got to praise right now in Jesus' name. So we're going to look at Psalm 55. And we're going to just read, first of all, and again, I would invite you to go back and read everything. But I want to just highlight a few things for our teaching today. So let's read verses 4 through 6. Now, if in fact, think about where David is now. And again, he is writing this psalm while on the run. Let's pick up verse 4 right here. Let's read that together, King James. My heart is sore pain within me, and the terrors of death are falling upon me. Fearfulness and trembling are come upon me, and horror hath ever overwhelmed me. Verse 6. And I said, oh, that I had wings like a dove, for then I would fly away and be at rest. You ever been there with stuff that's going on? Just want to get away from all of it. So David is at this point. But it's not a period right there. There's some more verses. Don't give up right there now. You're right this book. And keep on going. Let's read verse. Now look what happened. And just in case we were not clear, let's read verses 12 through 14 together. Verse 12. For it was not an enemy that reproached me. Then I could have borne it. I expect the enemy to be wrong. Keep going. Neither was it he that hated me that did magnify himself against me. Then I would have hid myself. So the people I knew who were against me, it's not them. Keep going. He says right in verse 13. But it was thou, a man, mine equal, mine God, and my acquaintance. Keep going to verse 14. We took sweet counsel together and walked into the house of God in common. Good Jesus. They walked and went to church together, served on the usher board together, sang in a praise team together, prayed together, worked together. Not somebody out there, but somebody close to him was fed that boy and still made this. Now look what happens. Now in the midst of all this, his heart is just troubled. He recognizes who it is that turns against him. But let's skip on down here to verse 22 right here at this point. In fact, yeah, verse 22 would be good. Let's read that. Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he will sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be removed. Come on, read that again. Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. One more time. Cast thy burden, whatever is weighing you down right now, whatever is troubling you right now, give that thing to God, come on, and he shall sustain thee. We'll look at the definition of that in just a moment. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. Now, David did not say, verse 22, cast your burden upon the Lord, and he will sustain you. He never suffers the righteous to be removed. He didn't say that after he was already delivered. He said it while he was on the run. See, anybody can talk about what you came through, how I got over, the question is, why are you in it? Can you say how I got over? The question is, do you trust God enough that when things are looking all bad and there's darkness all around, to know there's a light and there's a God, and God has already moved on your behalf, and it's just a matter of time, because this too shall pass. Have you ever been in a position when you start speaking? Because we got to change what we say in the valley. I got to start speaking valley when there's a victory, when I seem like in the valley. I got to start speaking faith when I feel like I have failed. I got to start speaking triumph when it looks like trouble's all around me. So David said, now I'm going to acknowledge right now I'm hurt, but I know God has not left me. I know right now I'm going through, but I know God is still on my side. I know my God is not going to keep me in this cave always. I know I'm about to be restored, and I'm going to be ready to be restored. Our problem is we get so used to being down that when we finally get out, we got to go back and change clothes. You got to get ready and get prepared for what. I love the fact of all of us have played sports or have children play sports or something, and I love the confidence of the kids that get ready to go to the state championship or to a championship game, and they already clear off the mantle before the game is played, because that's where the trophy is going to go. God has already said, you have already won the battle. So God, get rid of all the stuff that's on the shelf. Get rid of all the worry. Get rid of all the doubt. Get rid of all the fear. Get rid of all the anxiety. And get ready to put your favor on the shelf, because favor and victory already belong to you. So David didn't hit
sat right there in verse 6. I wish I had wings like a dove. Now see, this is what happens. Somewhere along this continuum,